And we're back, ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Got him back. It's going to be an amazing show today. We've got Onaje Muid with me coming back after a historical first appearance on the Philippe Matthews Show. Onaje specializes in creating cultural appropriate trauma-centered social justice human service systems to reverse historical trauma for oppressed populations. His 30-year counseling and administration career in the addictions warranted his appointment to the New York State Association of Substance Providers Board, the New York State Coalition Against Sexual Assault Board, and Columbia University School of Work. It's absolutely amazing the work that this man has done in the last 30 years as an advocate and activist for our people. Welcome back, Onaje Muid.
Thank you, brother. Thank you so much.
I want to start off with saying, I see you, I am here.
I am here.
I see you, I am here.
I am here.
I see you.
I am here.
I see you.
I am here. Thank you so much. You asked me to consider the question, what if we were healed from our historical trauma? And in contemplation, meditation, introspection about that question, you were really asking me a question from the future, looking back to the present.
Correct.
So with that, I would like to ask you to then, therefore, I'm going to say a phrase and you repeat after me, that if you, the audience, and we are speaking to each other in the future sometime, I would say to you, I am healed. And you would say,
I am healed.
And I would say to you, you are healed. And you would say,
you are healed.
And I would say to you, we are healed. And you would say,
we are healed.
And I would say to you, our people are healed.
Our people are healed.
And in this space that we find ourselves, this healing space, healed space that is, as in past tense, we are now in this broadcast, in this real time, listening to this conversation that we're having that's taking place in the future. And as you were so generously willing to be in the call and response, with me, I'm asking the audience now to say, I'm going to say to them, I see you, and I'm inviting them to say wherever they're at right now to say, I am here. And I'm saying again to the audience, I see you, and they are saying back to us, I am here. And I'm going to again say to them, I see you, and they are saying, I am here. And one last time, I'm going to say, I see you. And those in the audience would be so kind to say, I am here. The here we're talking about is this healed space. And if we were to look at it using the framework of esteemed elder Neely Fuller Jr. in his work, The United Independent Compensatory Code System Concept, and he provides a compensatory counter-racist code. If we were to use his nine areas of people activity, we would say that we have to look at that and say, well, what has happened because of the work we've done? I would just add a tenth one. Add is land/environment, because everything happens in context. And I would say in this healed space that we're looking back down in the past, in this healed space that we're in now, we have been sent an acknowledgement. Like the doggone say that they came from Osiris the dog star, right? We have been sent to Earth. We're acknowledging that we have been sent to Earth as caretakers of the land. And in this sacred heritage, inheritance, which provides the basic resources for all life and is protected in a manner, we have a responsibility to protect this land in a manner that we can transfer this inheritance seven generations hence. This is what we're acknowledging. So land and environment has to be a major part of this understanding of how we are connected to the cosmos. And in this acceptance, we are accepting our guardianship of the land, of the water, of the air, and of the sky. We as spiritual beings having a human experience are in fact the land walking, which is a miracle in and of itself. So we acknowledge the miracles that we are. And in this acknowledgement, we are caretakers of this physical plane on the land in which we exist, terra firma. So I would add that part in terms of his nine, I would say 10, because you have to speak about land. And it's really this absence of land baseness that has 99% of our problems. Because we don't feel we really have a land that we're connected to. And without that connection, we are just blown in the wind like leaves. And as you know, right now, back then, talking from the future, mm-hmm. back then we saw the shifts that our people were going from down south to up south, from up south to down south. We saw this shift because we was trying to re-establish ourselves. So therefore, looking at the nine areas, and I'm going to change the order in which he presents them. For me, this is how I see that it has to start with the base of spirit, land, of course, and then spirituality. So with respect to spirituality, again, we are in the future looking back. We adhere to and are experienced the fulfillment of spiritual laws of the universe by acknowledging the divinity in oneself and in others. And in this recognition, we establish divine order, divine balance, divine harmony, divine justice, and truth and reciprocity, otherwise known as the principles of Ma'at. In this healed space that we are in, politics now is understood as a natural power that we have with the universe, and it's for a reason, it's for a purpose, to acquire the means for our people to secure the resources for our survival and the fulfillment of our highest spiritual aspirations for the family, for the community, and for the nation. So politics has now been enlightened to see how it's connected to the natural order of things, connected to the natural powers of things. And we're making a distinction between the word power and the word authority. We get confused with the two, and therefore we give up our consent to be governed because we think that we have to submit to an authority that we don't respect. So now law, would you talk about politics, of course it has to be some kind of legal system in which we are beginning to, we have reformulated, and now law is the agreement we've made in informed consent to establish order and to establish justice by raising community and family as more important than the individual, and that individuals work with the families and families work with individuals and the communities work with each other to create a nation of order, of balance, of harmony and justice. The work that we do, the labor that we perform, all persons, all families and communities, we have committed ourselves to provide and to invest our intellectual, physical labor for the benefit of community well-being. Everything is thought of in the sense of community well-being. The word we use is wahimo misu. Wahimo misu means, which means repetition of the birth. In European terms, they talk about the Renaissance, but Wahimo Misu is our way of saying this rebirth. And we'll talk about that when we get into the healing historical trauma chart that we use to get to the place that we are now. So looking at the next area would be education. Education is to produce systems of mental, physical, spiritual, and social development and well-being. Economics. economics has now evolved to the point where we have been placed on the planet to share the resources of the planet that was already here. There's nothing that we create. The Creator has given us land, has given us food, has given us air, has given us water. We are beneficiaries of the Creator and that which has been created. So economics is the caretaking of these systems, very much so in keeping, as we said, as it relates to land. And then sex. Sex is considered a medium of communication, of love and affection and companionship. It's an affirmation of our bonding, and as well as the release of stress and tensions and isolation. It's a byproduct and the benefit of a healthy relationships that we are now all engaged in because we are healed people. I am healed.
I am healed.
You are healed.
You are healed.
We are healed.
We are healed.
Our people are healed.
Our people are healed.
And we are looking around and seeing this glorious state that we're in, and everybody is beaming and is laughing and dancing and drumming. This is the healed space that we're in when we have gotten to this point of healed trauma. And then the last area which fits right succinctly into that is in terms of entertainment. Therefore, our cultural entertainment has become an assortment of arts, including music, visual arts, media arts, dance, theater, as well as relaxation, that uplifts the spirit and soothes and invigorates the mind and comforts as well as strengthens the body. So those nine areas, plus one in terms of land, is a way of looking at that which is around us.
You forgot war and counter war.
Ah, thank you very much. Yeah, I guess that's in a healed space, there is no war, you see. From the reality. So we can look back at the time when we had to have those conversations. But we are past that now, you see. If we are healed as a people and our world is healed, that's not a conversation we have to have because it's one of the past. Why? Because we were able to understand the fundamental human dynamic in four parts. One is consent. Two is relationship. Three is empowerment. And four is abundance. When we are using that, every time we have a conversation, every time we have a meeting, every time we have any gathering of human beings, and we're using this as that is what we are intending to do, we can get to resolve. We might not optimize all that could happen in that space and that time, but we can get to resolve because there was enough for everybody. See, back then, one of the major conflicts that was driving the human dynamic was the question of scarcity.
Mm-hmm.
When you have a people who come from little and come from much of disease and pestilence and conflict and the lack of resources, that mentality of scarcity ran rampant upon the earth. But once we were able to convince and show that there is enough here for everyone, you can be secure in what you have, I can be secure in what I have. Once we were able to demonstrate that, people were able to relax. People were able to sit back. People were able to go back to their families and in love and respect and harmony and participate in the human existence in the way in which it was created. So actually, there was an unconscious reason why I left that out because we had already solved that. But just in case, we know that war and counter war is the right of self-defense. Mm-hmm. The right of preservation. And this is what Fuller talks about. He says that, you know, anytime violence is done, it's always in that of self-defense. And those of you who have the book, United Independent Compensatory Code. For those of you who have the book, you will notice back then he was saying some words we're not entitled to use because it would confuse us. And one of the words which was so strikingly missing from his conversations that we couldn't say we loved each other. Quite a heartbreak. We couldn't even say the word community back then because it didn't exist. So in the magic of words, people back then had us using words thinking that we had something and we didn't. And then the word became a symbol for something that didn't exist. Similarly to the dollar. You see, the dollar bill at one time was in fact a claim ticket on an amount of gold, then an amount of silver. And then it was Nixon who changed the treasury to say that it's just a certificate of deposit, nothing that not backed by gold. So the whole economy is now being run on this question of trust. See, if now if all the countries like China, Japan, probably Russia, I wouldn't be surprised if they called in and said, with all these dollars I have, I want something of value, a tangible value. And of course, gold was the first standard because gold is what immutable, right? And it's limited. So the same way in which the dollar is floating around and everybody is just operating on it as it means something is the very same way that we are using words today. Because the words we're using today aren't words that's back with the reality that exists. I mean, you know that, you know, a pimp will say to the person he's exploiting, I love you, and this is why I'm hitting you. Like, what kind of love is that? You know, of course, that's an extreme example of it, but we had back then, we had to look at the amount of times we were using the word love, and we had to look at the amount of times we were hurting each other. Because why we had internalized the people who were the people who were based in scarcity, we had ingested all of their concepts, we ingested all of their words, and we ingested all of their actions and behavior. So it wasn't too many things that we weren't doing that in fact they were doing, because we inherited their culture. But we had to go through, as I said before, Wahimi Misu, and in that rebirth, we're able to remember ourselves. So that's just the introduction.
Wow, what an introduction, my brother. In the space of talking about healing, being healed, and what if we were healed from our historical trauma? For those who have not had an opportunity of looking at and reviewing our first show together, unpack what historical trauma is, what it means to us as a people, how that relates to our genetic memory or epigenetics, and what Dr. Joy DeGruy talks about as post-traumatic slave syndrome or PTSS.
So back then, because we're still in the future, I'm in this healed space because I love seeing you healed, brother.
Absolutely. So we were explaining to the children what we went through and what we have overcome. What would that conversation look like?
It would look, okay, good question. At some point, we realized that the limitation of our healing was based upon the very essence of our oppression. We have denied the level, back then, we were denying for centuries the level of the hurt that we had experienced, because to acknowledge the hurt was an admission of guilt. if white people, when white people were saying to us, you're weak, you are stupid, you are slow, if they're saying these things, for us to say, I am hurt, and then he would say, see, I told you you're weak. If you say that, yeah, I'm having some difficulty learning these words, and this language is not my own. Yeah, I told you you were stupid. If we would say that, you know, I need some help because, you know, I just can't figure these things out for myself. See, I told you, that's because we're superior. So we had already bought into an inferior status by way of not admitting the hurt and the harm. So the first thing was to do, we did, was to admit the hurt. So our children we're saying to our children, we were hurt. Why? We are hurt through the four basic human rights violations. We were hurt through genocide. That was a trauma we experienced. We was hurt through war. That was another type of trauma we experienced. We was hurt through crimes against humanity. Another type of human rights experience. So all the, I said four, I can't think of the fourth one right now, but it's four major, like you might say, like we have misdemeanors and we have felonies, like the felonies of human rights or those three and one, this escapes my mind. But guess what? That's enough. You know, any one of them was enough.
Absolutely.
So we started to say we were victims of these tragedies. And we said, use the word ma'afa. And once we admitted to the hurt that we was feeling, then it gave us the ability to embark upon the healing. And the healing came forward in four affirmations. I am healing.
I am healing. Healing.
We are healing.
We are healing.
Our people are healing. We started to say that, and we started to use that in our family situation. We started to use that in our community meetings. We started everything off in our, anytime we got together, that's what we would do. That's how we started things off. So we were giving ourselves permission to acknowledge the hurt that we had, we were experienced, and we also gave ourselves permission to forgive others for the hurt that we've done to each other. See, at a certain point back then, when Europeans dominated people of color, we could see in the initial assault that it is them assaulting us. We could see them. We could attach the pain to them. It was the one-to-one relationship. But over the centuries, we internalized what they were doing to us, internalized the culture in our words, in our behaviors, in our family systems. And then we became the ones administering the hurt to each other. It back then it was so bad that grandmothers used to say to their children, no, you have to beat that boy and you got to make him understand who's the boss. No, you got to shame that boy to make sure that he knows that this is not wrong. We had mastered the art of shaming each other. We had mastered the art of humiliating each other. And in that humiliation, it just created centuries and centuries of pain and confusion and turmoil. So the people that you're looking towards for love and support and guidance are the same people who are hurting you. And for centuries, we couldn't understand that. And therefore, the person who started that hurt and pain was invisibilized. And in their invisibility, they became... there wasn't even exonerated. It didn't need to be exonerated because there was never a question of guilt. It was just that, no, this is what you do to each other. You see, back then we had people talking about the culture of poverty, and we had people talking about the culture of miseducation. We had all these words that would blame the victim. So once we decided to say, no, I am hurting. And we started to say, I hurt you. You see, it's not just a question of you being hurt from in the environment in which you're living. It's you being truthful enough to say, I hurt you. And if we go back and look at our, and we did, we looked at the ways in which we hurt each other. And then we went back and we said to them, when I was out of my mind, when I was out of my African mind, this is what I did to you. and I'm so sorry, will you forgive me? And with this forgiveness, so we affirmed, I am healing, you are healing, we are healing, our people are healing. We use that in terms of our family systems. We use that in terms of our community meetings. We use that as far as our societal context. And then we filtered that into all of the 9+1 areas that I spoke of earlier. Everything that we did, be it in terms of relationships, be it in terms of economics, politics, we started to infuse the healing in all of those conversations. So then those things became systems of healing for us. Right now, all of those systems are used as systems of as weapons against us. How do we know that? Because we can look at the health. We can look at the health our people experience, the mental, physical, economic, political, society. We can look at the health, and so we don't have any well-being. And we only got to the point where we could have well-being because we were using a healing framework for each one of those 9 areas, plus one in terms of environment. And then what that did, that lifted us up spiritually. So we had a spiritual renewal. Again, always reaffirming Wahimbe Misu, right? An Egyptian or Kemetic term that means rebirth. So we're constantly rebirthing ourselves. Getting back to the cycle that Marimba Ani talks about, the cycle of Ma'at, that moves to saying, that we forget, we move to saying, Ma'at, truth, balance, all the beautiful things we want from life, a metaphor for that. Moving away from it, forgetting, moving into this forgetfulness, and we had to be rebirthed in Sankofa to return to that which we lost, going through a period of transformation and finally landing again back into Ma'at, and then forgetting again, having to move back into Sankofa, and then moving back up into Ma'at. So then moving back into those, not just circles, but those spirals, because every time we come around, the spirals are getting wider and wider and wider. So that was the way in which we were able to be here today in this healed space by employing this historical trauma healing framework.
In the future, if we're having this conversation to our children and telling them what historical trauma was, past tense, one of the tools that was used was what you call the historical framework chart.
Mm-hmm.
Speak to us about that and unpack that for us.
Okay, that chart is what I just spoke to, where it has boxes. In industrial engineering and in industry, you have things which are called flow charts.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Flow charts is showing where something begins. It says, will it go forward? It says, will it go left? Will it go right? Will it have a delay? In each step in the process of making something, there's an action taken or there's no action taken, right? So the actions which are taken are the deliberate actions that will actually get you to the finished product. And I'm using the idea of creating a car. Mm-hmm. You have a framework, the car was going down the assembly line, and you having these different ingredients put onto the chart, put it onto the frame to finally get to the car, when it's finished. Now, also in planning, there's something called the critical path method. The critical path method is an item that has to be shipped from someplace else that has to come into the plant and be at the plant at the time in which that part is being used. Now, if that part is not there at the time that it's needed, it's going to push the timeline out for when it actually can be fully manufactured, fully assembled. So in any process, there's something called the critical path method. So for us, we were able to, because of the education tools that we acquired, we were able to create a critical path method to know that these things are unreproachable and non-negotiable. There were certain, we got to a point where we said, that's non-negotiable. If my son is graduating from school, the world stops. all the ways and all the things that back then that stood in the way of creating family cohesion, we were able to identify those things and says, this is our critical path. And then more and more families started to do that. More and more the children felt secure by not just their families, but by the traditional way of the village. Mm-hmm. I remember, you know, once I was in New York City and I saw the sign that says, yes, it takes a village to raise a child. And then underneath it says the question, where is the village? Mm-hmm. So now we found a way how to recreate the village by first attending to our children and being there when they needed us to be there. And everything started to take second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth priority. The more families started to do that, the children felt more secure about themselves and their social situation. And then at that point, we started to reverse the social war that was waged against us. See, when we think of war, we think war is just, you know, I have a gun or I have some kind of weapon, right? And I use that weapon against you. That is just the first string. Really, it's the second. The first one is communications. The second is the physical, and the third is psychological. So my studies have taught me that we as a people didn't appreciate the extent to which our social systems were destroyed and attacked. All the ways and means that they did this. Now this point here is going to be maybe a little sticky for our audience to consider. I'm pretty much in the beginning stage of like doing this research. In the 1800s, they had the doll rolls. The doll rolls was this piece of paper that said who was native and who wasn't. They had freedmen categorized in that on the doll's rolls. And if you go back and look at the census, you find many families who were native were both, they were on the doll's rolls as a native, and they was also on the freedmen rolls. So the question is like, who are we talking about? So we don't really know the mixture of those of us that came from Africa and those of us that's already here. This is a big area that is yet to be really researched and understood. I happen to have Lenape on both my mother's side and Lenape on both my father's side. I don't know their names. I don't have a family tree, but through history and you know, conversations and stuff, and my last family union, that's when I found out the Lenape on my father's side. So at this point, we don't know. At that point, we didn't know really how much of us was, part of us was African and how much part of us was native. We didn't really know that. But we came to a decision that didn't matter. Whoa, it didn't matter. Like, what do you mean it didn't matter? Well, it didn't matter because if I'm treating you with respect, I'm treating you with love, then that's what we can do. We can only live in the now. Yes, we have the historical imprint through epigenetics. We have those imprints, but we can escape those imprints. And the way we found to escape those imprints is to say that wasn't the essential issue. The essential matter was, can I be human? All of indigenous people, they always had the people this, the people that, the people who were carriers of the water. It was always the people. It wasn't so much a particular type of person or, if you will, ethnic group, right? All those things came into existence with European domination and thought because of their inferiority complex about not being able to be with the majority of humanity, being heavily melanated people. Their absence of that melanin created this identity thing that they then therefore superimposed, they projected it on us. And then we became, individualized. We became, I have to be this own distinct person, not being able to embrace the whole. So we were able to rebirth ourselves in the fullness of humanity. That's what's missing now. And this is what Fuller talks about. You know, he talks about all known persons everywhere, right, engaging in justice and peace. He didn't say just Africans. He didn't just say Europeans. He just didn't say Native Americans. He said all known people everywhere engaging in the practice of justice and peace. So that gives, so what we're able to do was to reverse Blumenbach, his whole theory of the races. We was able to go back to a time before that existed, and therefore we were living in a different paradigm, the biggest paradigm that says Mita Koye Oyase, all our relations, the two-leggeds, the four-leggeds, those that swim, those that fly, those that crawl, we were able to get back into the natural order of ourselves being a component of the universe and creation.
Wow. That's awesome. That is beautiful, my brother. Thank you for sharing that. You also shared with me as we were preparing for this show, the power of the medicine wheel. You sent me quite a few. We're going to be working together and producing your free e-course on this. Speak to us about the significance of the medicine wheel in restoring our epigenetic injuries and historical trauma as we're telling this to our children in the future about what happened to us and how we began to heal ourselves.
When we re-examined this notion of being distinct people and not being part of the, if you will, the human race, human society, whatever we call it, we started to ask the question, who owns what? And then we realized that the reason that the world went through such a horrific underdevelopment was through this question of ownership. And what illustrates that is when Europeans came to indigenous people and said, I want to buy land, they looked at them and laughed and said, yeah, you want to buy land? Okay, fine. So the idea that you could come up with the concept that you can own land, that you can own your mother, was so far-fetched. It's like, man, these people are really, really, wow. Yeah, okay, get whatever you got. You want to give me that? I'll give me that. There is no ownership. The closest thing that we have to ourselves is our body, right? I own my body. Do you? Let me see how long you can keep it. Can you keep it for 50 years? Can you keep it for 100 years? Can you keep it for 200 years? Can you keep your body that you think you own for 500 years? No. Your soul will leave your body and it will go into whatever the spiritual dimensions all of us have thought existed after this existence. So the whole idea of ownership is just a false idea. So we got to the point where we realized that there is no ownership. The best we can do is be caretakers for that which we have, this body that we have, this family that we've been given. So with this idea of eliminating ownership, we were able to create new relations with ourselves. The specific question you asked me is, say it again.
About the medicine wheel, the significance of that in our historical healing.
So the medicine wheel is in fact an example of that. The medicine wheel is saying that we are born into existence. As a baby, as an infant, we mature. We in the East, we come into the West, we come to the South, in terms of we become a teenager, and then we come up to the West where we become an adult. And then we, if we're living long enough, we become an elder in the North. That's just one way in which we can talk about the medicine wheel. So we started to see that we all are in transition. Nothing is static. We're always in transition from one thing to the next. And then we started to use the medicine wheel as a way, when we talked about the family coming together, we talked about the community coming together, we talked about what was happening in society, we started to use the medicine wheel in all of those interactions, and we're able to, one, identify. So when we said, I see you, I am here, people will begin to say, I am here. I'm in the north, or I'm in the south, or I'm in the east, or I'm in the west. We're able to say where we were in the conversation. And because we were able to identify where we were, we could then therefore identify where we had to go. Mm-hmm. So we started to look at economics and saying that as a people, we were in the east, the very beginning of really understanding how the economic systems worked. And then we educated ourselves in terms of what we have to do. We created SUSU. I haven't spoken to you about SUSU yet. SUSU is, I don't think I did, I might have. Anyway, SUSU is Saba Uhuru, Saba Ujija, the seven freedoms and the seven villages. We're using SUSU first in the manner of creating a space where we were agreeing to be together. And then we stayed together long enough where we then started to circulate the ideas in which we wanted to accomplish, the projects, the community projects that we wanted to engage in. And then we started to help each other. Then we got to the highest level of SUSU where we started to investing, right, putting up $100. And many people from the Congo, some parts of Ghana, and certainly in the Caribbean, they're already doing this. These are things that they've been doing back. They were doing it more so than those of us here in the United States of America and throughout the Americas. So we started to use both the healing circle as a way of placing things. And when you have the circle on the floor, you're looking at it, and it gives you a certain level of literacy that you don't have if it's just inside. So when we write things down, right? Mm-hmm. We have thoughts in our mind. We take the thoughts in our mind and we use our hand and we create words and we put the words on the paper. So once we see the words on the paper, it gives us a framework. We can put things in perspective, and then we take the words and we put them back into our minds, and then we live a different kind of a way. Well, it's the same thing with the medicine wheel. When we have the medicine wheel, we're using it, we're putting it down, we can begin to, back then we saw our pain, we saw our hurt, and we were able to find areas of opportunities of healing. Mm. And without that way of like seeing it outside of yourself, we stayed in the confusion that the oppression had created in our minds. So by using the healing circles, we're able to deconstruct that which was happening, that which was going on, and more importantly, to envision where we wanted to go. So another medicine wheel, I was taught this through Shirley Terracott, her course, Aboriginal Focus Oriented Therapy for Complex Trauma. And the way that we use that as a therapy that many of our people got trained in and started to use, we use that to see in our spiritual and emotional growth where worry. Now, you could be 40 years old, but you still could have the emotions of a 12-year-old. In fact, in substance abuse, we say, you know, that whatever point you started to use drugs is the point where you left off your emotional growth. So Eric Erickson talks about these stages of change as human beings go through these different tasks we have to do, right, going through these different stages. So we were able to use AFOT just as that became the normality of what we did. Everybody's, you know, was going to get trained and everybody's using. So it wasn't just those who were considered counselors, it wasn't just those who was considered social workers, wasn't those who just were considered human service providers. All of us became human service providers because we were servicing each other. Very similar to the National Association of Black Social Workers. The National Association of Black Social Workers understood that it wasn't going to European schools that made you a social worker. If you were doing work in the community, you was a social worker. So could we say that because Marcus Garvey didn't have a social work degree that he wasn't a social worker?
No, we can't say that.
It's ridiculous, right? So we got to, in law, we say there's such a thing called law de jure and de facto, right? De jure is that which is written down and you can point to it, and de facto is that it's happening anyway. So we were beginning to distinguish birds that were hurting us, either de jure or de facto. We began to distinguish the patterns of behavior, and see, a big part of this is the question of forgiveness. Forgiveness became a major part, because with the forgiveness came the ability for people to acknowledge what had happened. They acknowledged the crime, the hurt, and in forgiveness, they were able to have their humanity acknowledged. And you see, that's what Europeans then didn't allow us to. They didn't allow us to, so even, not even talking about the ones who were put in prison for a crime that they did commit, right? Not even talking about the people who were put in jail for a lesser crime that really didn't amount, not even talking about them, talking about the people that actually committed the crimes, hurt people, either robbing or stealing. And what Fuller said back then was that when they do that, give them a gun or give them whatever weapon they use for the damage and put them in isolated confinement. And then, since that gun or that knife is their friend, then befriend your friend. So you can stay there until you die, or you can stay there until you kill yourself. That was the choice that you have. Since you wanted to use it for someone else, now use it on yourself. That's how he decoded it, right? So it didn't go to that extent. But what we started to do is we started to acknowledge that there were reasons why those persons did what they did. And we started to use what was called restorative justice. Restorative justice says less punishment and more healing. We started to use that in our school system, so we had less conflict in the schools. We started to use that in the prison systems, where people who had murdered, you know, someone, so let's say that this man's son murdered that man's son. And what would happen is that the son who was lost became the other person's son. So we had a way of just training. And in fact, let me just say that in the Quran, it speaks about the law of equity. You know, basically a tooth for a tooth, an eye for eye. You know, sum it up. But it said, if you knew better, you would forgive. So forgiveness is the higher form. And you had someone in here who showed us the highest level of forgiveness. I'm talking about Butch Slater, when you had him on your show. And people who haven't seen that show, you have to go back and look at that interview. This man is a walking miracle. A miracle only because it's not happening nearly enough. Because it's out of the norm. It's out of the regular. But if it's happening all around, it becomes what the norm.
So you're talking about a story about Butch, Ulysses Butch Slaughter, who, he didn't see it, but his father basically killed his mother.
No, he saw it.
Oh, he saw it. He saw it. And his father came in and his life was, I think it was 12 years old or?
12 years old. His father said, she was about to leave us. I had to do it.
Yeah.
Again, using the concept of what? Possession, of ownership.
Right.
See how ownership will take you down the wrong path every single time? Patriarchy, what is it based upon? Ownership. The man is in charge and I own you and you do what I tell you. This question of ownership and the question of authority. That these are the two things if ownership and authority is present, you're going to have confusion, you're going to have death, you're going to have problems. So it's not ownership, it's stewardship. Mm-hmm. And it's not authority, it's consent.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In this future conversation that we're having with our children, explaining to them historical trauma, and how we were healed from it.
Using the medicine wheel. Using the SUSU system.
Another conversation that would come up that is happening now is, and what you're involved in and brought to my attention, the actualizing.
What now are you talking about? We're in the future.
Well, we're talking about the United Nations a decade for people of African descent. We're talking about
back then.
Back then, the conversation that began in the political realm, where the United Nations started to take. I think it's the last. I forgot what year we're in, but 10 years to talk about our historical trauma and some level or form of reparation and acknowledgement of that. Where are we in that conversation?
Okay, back then, the United Nations did say, they did declare 2015 to 2024 the decade for people of African descent. And in that conversation, there were three principles. We wanted to actually have reparations as one of those principles, but we got were substitutes, but good substitutes. Recognition, justice, and development. So you can see how reparations being the repair of a harm or a hurt, you could see that reparations would certainly include recognition of the hurt. You can see how it would include justice in terms of healing the hurt, and then you can also see how it would go a step further in terms of development. That was the whole purpose of reparations, is mm-hmm. to give people the environment to develop themselves again. So the question didn't become really strong enough until the demand became strong enough. The demand didn't become strong enough until the education became strong enough, where then we were starting to use the words on a regular basis. So there wasn't any conversation in the family, there wasn't any conversation in the community without saying, you know, what do we need to understand about reparations today? Mm-hmm. That first, that internal reparations was the reparations of admitting the hurt that we had done to each other and apologizing to the person and asking for forgiveness. Mm-hmm. There was a level of internal reparation that occurred. And then because of that internal reparations that occurred, we started to create critical mass. Enough of us were able to come together, have meetings, and to organize. And then the more we came together, the greater our trust built up. And with that trust, the greater things we're able to do, sharing our intelligence, sharing our resources. And we were able to organize, African people all over the globe, people of color all over the globe, anybody who had been hurt. We started to create conferences in most unlikely places. Having conferences with Armenians who were victims of the genocide in Turkey, having conferences with Jews who were victims of genocide in terms of Europe, all the people who were hurting started to come together. And maybe, Maria Yellowhouse Braveheart, a good friend and a teacher, might have been the seed when she created the first series of conferences back in 2001. I think it was like four of them, or three of them. I had participated. I missed the first one. It was three. I missed the first one because I didn't know about it. The second one, I was a participant, and the third one, I was on the national board. So those conferences brought different people together who experienced genocide and was talking about the hurts as humans, not as victims, not as perpetrators, but as humans, and looking at it and saying, okay, what do we do now? So that type of work increased. It increased so much so that it became public discourse. Mm-hmm. Well, first it started to shift public opinion. Then after public opinion, it became public discourse. And then third, then it became public policy. Mm-hmm. So now what happened is that which was considered the problem of the person, right, because they've been pathologized up until that point, we moved it from pathology and moved it into the realm of public health. And then all the public health departments started to use that. It also used the work of Commissioner Bassett, the Commissioner of Health in New York City, I guess the largest, maybe one of the largest public health public institutions in the world, and certainly in the United States, maybe second to California. But what Bassett did was to say, okay, let's look at what we got. We have a system of white supremacy, of racism, and we have consequences. And these consequences are happening in terms of the rate of renal failure. It's happening in terms of heart attacks. It's happening because of asthma. And every single health determinant she looked at, she saw there was a corresponding racist construct around it. Who had the highest level of asthma? Well, it was those Black and Puerto Rican children who lived in the community where the bus stations were actually placed. Every single health indice had a racist correlation to it. So she started to look at environmental racism. So she said, well, we have to look at racism. We have to see how it's happening inside our institution. We have to then create a mechanism, start to collect all the data about it. And then we have to look at the communities who were harmed through structural racism and begin who were under-resourced and start to give those communities resources. So the model that was started in New York City was spread out. It went to Chicago, it went to Detroit, it went to Atlanta, it started going to all the places where you had a major Black population, where you had significant Black, in some cases, major populations. It went to DC, then all those public health, public, you know, city, and then it went from the city, then it went to the state, and then it finally got pushed up to the federal government. Mm-hmm. But it took many years for that to happen because you had people who still didn't want to recognize us as human, let alone recognize that we needed to be healed from the hurt that they caused. But we're able to migrate that external concept that wasn't even used before, which was the hurt itself, historical trauma, was able to bring that to the center and was able to grow that first through the city public institutions, then through the state, then through the federal government. And because we were existing in this decade, right, people of African descent, other countries started to chime in as well. So you had a crescendo that took place where a chorus, you know, started to come in terms of, yes, this is the hurt that the whole world is suffering from. And then well-intended white people started to give up their whiteness and started to say, I'm not going to. I remember back then I was bringing my grandson from New Jersey, East Orange, New Jersey. I was bringing him to New York to reunite him with his mother because he was with me that day when I had went through one of my Reiki initiations, the Kawuna initiations. And in the Penn Station in New York back then, there was a bunch of young people that looked like students. Most of them were white. And they had a whole thing of things they were saying to the crowd, and they would take turns. And the way they would do it is with one person would say, mic check, mic check, mic check. And then the whole audience would repeat what he had said. So you didn't have to have a megaphone. So the one person would say that in the United States, he said, in the United States, you know, 12-13% of the population, Black people, comprise over 50% of the prison industrial complex. Why is that? And why is that? It's because of slavery. I mean, they had a whole history lesson right there in the middle of Penn Station. And everybody's looking around. And what was curious was there was a wall of police officers that was standing there. Now, what are you telling me? We can't have free speech? We can't speak to each other? So what it did was show that you can speak to each other only in individual conversations, in limited conversations. But once you create critical mass in terms of getting your message out, well, then that's a problem, because then that's political. That's not a social conversation anymore. That's a political conversation. But so these young or these white people were doing things that were unheard of. You know, they started to analyze, you know, well, where did the whole whiteness concept come from? What was the purpose of it? And they were starting to band together. And then they decided to commit. Before they used to call it revolutionary or class suicide, they created race suicide. They said, "I'm giving up my wife. I'm an English person. I'm the whole white notion." And then every time somebody would say it, they would correct them. So they started to work with the melanated people, and you had these. That's how those conversations got pushed, because they remember they were already in office. They were the commissioners. Or they were the mayors. They were the people who were in positions of power. So they had the ability to make those changes. And people were looking at them in astonishment. You had a mayor, you had a governor of Ohio that said there's he stopped capital punishment, because he saw that it was so many black people being committed to injections, that he said, no, this is wrong. So people started seeing things and started doing things, and people in power who had control started making laws. And then all this came together where they were able to create a developmental plan for reparations. And reparations, as you know, has three aspects, compensation, restitution, rehabilitation, and the fourth one is a monitoring system. So what happened also in that time is that Dwight Mullen, a sociologist from North Carolina, Asheville, created something was called Black Asheville. And in his work, he was able to get students to do this research to really look at what was the real situation that black people were living in terms of housing, right? Where were they living in terms of housing? Where did they sit in terms of the economics of the city? Where did they sit in terms of unemployment? He was able to not only gather that system, but he was able to teach students. And the students started to use those systems, and those students went out to all the different places where you have black concentrations. And then they taught them how to create a black Detroit, a black New York, a black Newark. So people started to get the information. So once they had the information, we talked about information, once it's visualized, right? When it's manifested in front of you, it gives you a higher level of consciousness, because then you can manipulate it, you can see the relationships, and then you can re-ingest it, and then you can take it up. So people started to see the numbers, and that encouraged our children to finally break the education, the de-education that we had gone through. There was a period of time when our children didn't want to learn. Mm-hmm. And they didn't want to learn from institutions that was basically racist. And we were able to break that, because we were able to, before our children were able to see the necessity for it. Deborah Pithrow Stitt, who is a doctorate in public health, who started the conversation that violence is a public health problem. It's not just a social problem; it's a public health problem. She spoke about the time when she was speaking to gang members, and then she gave them the explanation of the history, and she showed them how the slave catchers became the first police stations in the North. So you went from slave catcher to police. Same mentality, same method of torture, of brutality, of dominance, of terror, right? She gave them a history of that. And she gave them the history of like how drugs were sent into the community as a way to divide people up, so that you would get the people to sell drugs to each other. And then that would demoralize the community as well as kill off the future. Mm-hmm. She went on to tell them that now this is a situation that you're in. You think that you are a blood and you think you are a Crip. You know what you are is a victim of a very sophisticated system of oppression. And they got angry. They said, "What the hell? What this is what they did?" They said, "Well, you know, you can do something about it." "Well, what can we do about it?" I said, "You can go to school."
Nice.
"And you can study this, and you can learn, and you can teach me all the stuff that I don't know." So we were able to reverse the trend of our children not being interested in education, and then they started to go back to school. And then the community woke up. Most often when the youth wake up, the community wakes up, and we started to use charter schools. More charter schools started popping up all over the place with curriculums that were about the history. Curriculums about health. Curriculums about what to do. So you had this intelligence. You had this wealth of intelligence that started to birth from the children that were sent here. The children that were sent at different times to bring what they needed to complete that which we was creating, which was a new human being.
Love that. Thank you for that. You sent me what's known as the Vicarious Trauma Toolkit. Speak to us about what is vicarious trauma, and what is in this toolkit, and how can people access this toolkit so that we can begin to have this conversation in the future to heal our people and heal our population.
Yeah. Well, during that time when it started with this HBO, this health management health organization out in California, and they did a study in over 19,000 white people. It was an obesity study, and in this study they found out that even if you give people a program to lose weight, because it started off with obesity, and they gained the weight back, there was something more to it than what met the eye. And then they started to do the research into the histories of all those persons and found out that if they were abused as a child, sexually or emotionally or physically, there was a higher percentage that they would actually develop some type of heart problems in the future. And it was called the ACE studies. So the ACE studies became popular. In fact, the state of Washington used it as its public health framework. And then more schools started to use what was called trauma-informed services. So all the schools in which oppressed people were living and barely surviving, they started to bring in this question of trauma. What trauma did, it was using the ACE studies to like actually measure the trauma. And then from that, they was able to put together a program. So it wasn't just an education program that became relevant and useful for each student. It was also a trauma development program or de-escalation program that was developed, not only for the child, but for that whole school and for that region. And then in that, people started to say, well, it's not just the children that need this information about trauma. It's also the teachers themselves. Mm. It's also the parents themselves. It's also the community itself. So then we began to understand the way that trauma, one traumatized person could in fact traumatize another person. And it wasn't always like every person would respond the same way. When there's a traumatic event, what is assaulted is, yes, your body, but also your mind, how your mind is constructed. And once your belief system is bent, is twisted, the person that you are is no more, because now you're someone else. So people start to see that the trauma that other people were experiencing, they were starting to experience those same symptoms. Not sleeping at night, eating too much food, not exercising, being depressed. And then people started to say, hey, every time we come together, again, it went back to the question of health and well-being. People started to use that in every situation. So vicarious trauma became part of the schools. It became part of the prison system, right? If somebody's a prison guard, and they're in the environment of hostility. In fact, if they are the ones who are creating the violence, right, or in some cases responding to it, you don't think they're going to be responded to? and have the same consequences they would. So we understood that the gang members were experiencing trauma the very same way that people went to war and experienced trauma, right? Which was called post-traumatic stress disorder. We started to say that these are humans, and just because they're in a different political relationship doesn't mean they are will experience the trauma any less. So there was a public shift where we started to look at and working with a program called Cure Violence that was looking at violence as a public health crisis. So vicarious trauma is when you are close to someone where you didn't experience the violent act, but you're starting to, in fact, internalize the symptoms of that act. It happens first responders that comes to an accident where someone's, you know, been a car accident, fire, police officers, social workers, psychologists. Those professions are the professions that usually experience vicarious trauma the most. But does that say that the mother who has lost her child through gang violence, is that to say that she's not experienced vicarious trauma? She is too. So the whole question of trauma started to open up, and we started to look in places. We started to shine the flashlight where it hadn't been shown before, and then we started to see where people were healing and were hurting, and then we started to create different interventions for that healing.
Fantastic. Thank you for that.
And the big thing that happened along that was like, okay, since we found ourselves in that system of this hurt and this pain, dehumanization, the question became, how do we protect the children?
Mm-hmm.
So they created these systems to turn off the televisions. That was the biggest thing. When they turned off the televisions, it wasn't giving children the already listening that violence is acceptable.
Mm-hmm.
You turn on the television as a child and you see cartoon characters hitting each other with the head. It's like, oh, this is how you solve your problems.
Mm.
So first it started with an hour. You know, in black families, we say, okay, for this hour, we're not going to do it. Then they went to, okay, this day, we're not going to do it. Then they, you know, it took a number of years for this to happen now, but the families that started to do this, they were the ones that started to create the internal healing. And then they got to a week. And then after a week of not looking at television, they came to the point like, wait a minute, we're not arguing as much as we used to.
Uh-huh.
They started seeing things and like, I'm having conversations with you. You know, I'm telling you how I'm feeling. They saw that, then they asked themselves the question, well, why should I turn back on the TV? So they started turning off TVs all across the country, and they started to have dinner together again with their families the way we used to. And then all the things that we had already experienced slowly started to come back into existence, having family table, manners, respect for the elders, going to other people's houses, exchanging food. We started to create village again, because we were able to turn away from the distractions. And they weren't distractions. These were intentional, critical entities that was placed to make sure that we wouldn't create these relationships.
Uh-huh.
Of course, people at the top knew that if the people at the bottom, be it the black, the red, yellow, people at the bottom, when they started to work together, they would see that the whole system existed only because of their consent.
Wow.
And the system just fell out. People just started, you know, just not doing things the way they used to. And things started to say, okay, I can't make any money over here. So all the leeches, you know, are where they started to sell drugs. When there was nobody out to sell drugs to, who are they going to sell drugs to? There's nobody there. If nobody's coming to the corner to buy the drugs, who are they? What, they're going to knock on somebody's door and say, you want some drugs?
Right.
So the people started to be with family, and they would start to move in caravan. Like when they would go across town, they would two or three cars. They would move it. They started to understand that not everybody was going to make it to the promised land. And that was another major part where people started to use the concept of triage. In medical terms, triage is when you come into the hospital, determination is made. It's usually in war. If you're in the battlefield, if I give you medicine, if I don't give you the medicine that you would still survive, I'm not giving you the medicine. If I give you the medicine and I think that you're going to die, I'm not giving you the medicine. I'm only giving the medicine to the person who this is going to be the way this person lives. It was a very harsh reality to employ. But when you're in a war situation, you have to have a war psychology. So our people were able to mature themselves saying, hey, people, we didn't declare this war. We didn't start this war. Well, we're definitely in a war, and then we have to now think in terms of war. So people started picking up Fully's book, you know, the United Independent Compensatory Code. People started, that became a study guide where people started to use it, and then people started to look at the words they were using, and they said, according to the code, we can't use this word. They started to actualize that which was in print. They started to actualize that in terms of their family culture. Then it became community culture. And then in this war strategy, we're able to stop hurting each other. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then the powers that be had to shift. So it got very difficult because they were intent on keeping us in that situation. So we lost a lot of lives because they started to arrest, you know, the police brutality increased. It got worse before it got better.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. As we see now, in terms of looking back, we see in this time that we're living in what is happening right now.
Yeah.
I so appreciate you, my beloved. You are absolutely amazing.
No, you are, because I hadn't thought about these things before until you asked me to think about it.
my late metaphysical minister, the Reverend Dr. Johnny Coleman, and the Reverend Dr. Helen Carey, who's still with us, would always say, live the wishful dream already fulfilled.
Mm.
And I keep that with me as I try to do the work that I do, develop the intellectual properties that I do, present the shows that I do, that what would it look like, or what would it be like if we were already healed, starting with the end in mind, with the goal already manifested and reached? What would that look like, and how would we arrive to that, and then reverse engineer that, and living in that state of living the dream, the wishful dream already fulfilled? Because sometimes, as you know, we get into the forest and we can't see the trees because we're in the fight. We can't see it from the seats because we're out there and it's like, oh, I got to survive. If we can pull back, step back, we can look at how can we strategically, if you will, militarily, in terms of our thinking, remove ourselves from this race hate, this race war, that we're already in a race war. It's amongst ourselves. How do we do that? And that is why I wanted to have you come on. I said there's no other better person to have this conversation with than you, and to begin this conversation, a series of conversations on this. And so I just want to thank you for being the beloved healer and way shower that you are.
I'm a servant, you know. I attempt to be a servant. All praises due to the Creator, and all mistakes are mine. Those who are practicing the month of Ramadan, I would say Ramadan Kareem to you, blessed Ramadan to you. And what I realize, would also realize, I think this is an important point here. Spirituality is like the wind. It goes in and out. You really can't see it. And there are certain places, the way the earth is shaped, that will be more susceptible to catch the wind than other places.
Mm.
We are those containers of spirituality. So when someone says spirituality, we catch it. So we gave up the idea that it didn't make a difference if he was a Christian. We gave up the idea it didn't make a difference if he was a Muslim. We gave up the idea it didn't make a difference if you were a person who didn't believe in God per se, but you acknowledged that there was a thing called the universe. So we gave up those ideas that one had to do this in order for us to be kind to you, that one had to be that before I would speak to you. We gave up those ideas because we began to see how childish and how foolish they were. And that was a major part of the Black community coming together, because the word they used then was ecumenical. And those more ecumenical types of spiritual gatherings became. Why? Because when you went to the block and someone got shot, either by another Black person or by a cop, it could have been a Muslim, it could have been a Christian, it could have been a Jewish. We started to see that there's something more basic than these labels and these frameworks we put on ourselves, and we're able to go beyond that. So we started to having, we were able to use the concept of pluralism. That is to say that one could be distinct in his or her own way, but also be a part of a larger collective. And the principle of pluralism found itself in all the dimensions of life. So it found itself in terms of how people related to their particular faith or spiritual tradition. So things became more equitable. It evidenced itself in terms of the politics, where America became, the United States of America, and I had to correct myself, it's not, people who say America thinking that it's the United States of America, but you disappear North America, you disappear Central, and you disappear South America. So we can't use the word America if we're not talking about the whole continent of the American continent. And we have to talk about a country by itself, because then when you say America meaning United States, you're already engaging in racist, oppressive language. Mm-hmm. So in the United States, it evolved to a point of pluralistic where nations became recognized as a multinational state, because then it was, and we talked about this in the last program, as Yusef Clyde points out, the white ethnic, those who became white, they had to give up the ethnicity of being Irish, of being English, of being Scottish. They had to give that up, and they bought into this force concept that came into existence called whiteness after the Beacon Rebellion. And then therefore they create this white ethnic. But after a while, people started to see that this is a trick. You have this white ethnic that he's usurped state power and called itself one nation. In fact, there was many nations, but they used the one nation concept. From the many comes the one, and they were able to see through that. And when people started to go back to their own nationalities, being, English, being Irish, when they started to create their culture, they felt more part of the human family, because then they have something to offer. They didn't have to copy off of Black people anymore. They didn't have to follow rap music. And that was a whole another discussion about the whole music entertainment industry. But people started to fall back from that, and then they started to say, well, I can recognize you for who you are, and I can still be me. Uh-huh. And we can have a political place for us to coexist. So you had mentioned earlier the whole thing about the United Nations. So there was a plebiscite that took place. A plebiscite is when people vote their political destiny. They engage in a political conversation around those three levels of humanity: consent, relationship, empowerment, abundance. The plebiscite is saying, okay, let's start with consent. What do I want my relationship to be to this country called America? And then people said, well, I'm not American. I won't be one until I get reparations. That was a demand. So what came from that was a pluralistic society where you had different nations have an ability to run their own affairs. See, because segregation was used as a form of oppression, What it did was to take away the central character of human beings. Human beings like to be with human beings, the same human beings that think alike. There's nothing wrong with that. But when you say that you have the right to dominate someone else, right, because of the way you think over someone else, that's when it becomes a problem. So when you see robins flying in the sky together. When you see fish, you see all the fish, same fish flying. This is a natural occurrence. So you can have a pluralistic society where people can be amongst themselves and they can be in a larger society as well. So we were able to figure that out. And in figuring that out, we were able to enjoy the resources that were here in America, in the United States, the United States of America. And then also that became the campaign to go back and claim responsibility for the earth. So indigenous people, they became in charge of EPA, and then they started to put all their practices in place. So they started making prayers at different sites, and money was allocated for the cleanup. So we were able to transform the whole capitalist system based upon greed and acquisition, and was able to transform that system to a system of coexistence and harmony. And that means people started to create new type of sciences, where we could clean up the water, where we could clean up the air. So when people had clean water to drink, when people had clean air to breathe, they became clear-minded. And in their clear-mindedness, they was able to create new ways of being and different things that we never thought of before. So when we look around now and see our people healed, we see this world came about because we had to fast. Fast meaning we had to get rid of those toxins, mm-hmm. those mental, physical, spiritual toxins that was holding humanity back. So we went through that process, was able to evolve and use pluralism in different places, and then that became coexistence. So the medicine wheel, again, started to be used in more and more places. Every place there was a medicine wheel, because we ourselves are medicine wheels. So we have to heal ourselves. We heal ourselves. Our family is the medicine wheel. So we are using, what I talked about, the concept of ownership. We begin to say, well, who owns anything, right? All of us are given this from some place, from someone, from the universe, from the creator. And then we were able to give up that concept of ownership and take on the concept of stewardship. And then things just started to fall into place naturally.
Wow. I am healing.
I am healing.
You are healing.
You are healing.
We are healing.
We are healing.
Our world is healing.
Our world is healing.
I love you, my beloved. I love you.
I see you.
I see you. I am here.
I see you.
I am here.
I see you.
I am here.
I see you.
I am here. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a show that I want you to take and study, take and share, use it as a way to set your day or set your week or set your month, because it's about this historical, healing our historical trauma is first healing ourselves and creating a sacred space within ourselves, to do that, to allow that, so that once we go out into the distractions called life that we're living right now, we are setting ourselves up epigenetically to affect the next three generations. And so this work that Brother Onaje Muid, I'm going to start referring to you as a master healer, because that's who you are to me. We call Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamade our master teacher. You are in that category as a master healer. I just want to honor that this is a sacred space and time. Whenever you view it, whenever you watch it, whenever you rewatch it and reshare it, to be in that space and to honor that space, use the affirmations that were given during this time with Brother Onaje. And I am working with Brother Onaje to help him release his free e-course using the digital nomic system that we're going to be releasing hopefully in the next 30 within the next 30 days or less. And I'll have those links, and I'll be sharing those links with you in this description, as well as throughout our social networks, so that you can make these affirmations and this process a part of your daily life and part of your daily ritual. And I just want to thank the Creator for aligning and leading Onaje Muid in my life at this sacred time. At age almost at age 51, that the world can collaborate, the universe can collaborate, and we can collaborate right now in real time and create this level of history. I love you, my brother.
I love you, my brother.
We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show. Stick around in the green room with me, my friend.